priming effect is when seeing or experiencing one thing makes our brain react faster or think differently when we encounter something related to it later. Our exposure to one stimulus influences our response to the following stimulus. The word prime means prepare or be ready for something. When painting a wall, we apply a coat of primer before the actual paint. The primer helps to prepare the surface, creating a better adhesion for the paint, covering stains and providing a consistent base color. Similarly, when it comes to cognition, we can prime people's mind with a particular stimulus to prepare their brain to process related information faster and in a certain way when we encounter it later. In one experiment, participants first read a paragraph and then selected their favorite detergents. Seemingly unrelated tasks, right? But there is a twist. If the paragraph they've just read had the word ocean, an overwhelmingly large number of participants instinctively reach for the Tide detergent. In my previous video, I introduced the anchoring bias, which is our tendency to rely heavily on the initial piece of information when making decisions. Anchoring bias is a result of many mental mechanisms, one of which is priming effect. The priming effect can trigger the anchoring bias. Another difference between the two biases is stability. The priming effect can disappear quickly. In fact, if you are aware that you are being primed, its influence mostly vanishes. By contrast, the anchoring bias is more robust and continues to play an important role in decision-making, often stubbornly persisting even after you understand its effect. The priming effect often operates below our conscious radar. Like invisible puppeteers, those hidden cues, which are primes, can nudge our decision-making process, causing us to act first and then construct a logical rationale for our actions later. As a result, we sometimes throw reasoning to the wind at critical moments only to reverse engineer justifications for our choices afterward. We've already learned that our brain is an energy-demanding organ and its resources are limited. To function efficiently, the brain seeks ways to minimize energy expenditure while maximizing cognitive performance. The priming effect is one mental shortcut that allows the brain to process information more effectively while conserving energy. Here is how it works. When the brain encounters a familiar stimulus, the prime, and subsequently encounters a related stimulus, the target, it can take advantage of previously activated neural pathways. Instead of starting from scratch to process the target stimulus, the brain can partially reuse the neural circuits that were activated during the prime exposure. This reduces redundant processing and conserves energy. Priming also facilitates memory retrieval. When the brain is exposed to a prime that activates a particular memory, it becomes more accessible in memory storage. This means that the brain does not have to engage in exhaustive search process to retrieve relevant information, saving energy in the memory retrieval process. Those mental processes allow our brains to deal with a wide range of cognitive tasks while keeping energy consumption in check. This energy-efficient processing is an important part of our brain's adaptive and resourceful nature. Now, think about where your team usually holds meetings. Does your team often discuss important issues in the stuffy, windowless conference room? Or does your team meet in an open, airy space with open views? It turns out that people are generally more open-minded and they're willing to explore a wider range of options when they meet in an open space. Have you noticed that when your team meets in stuffy, windowless rooms, Group discussions quickly spiral into a binary deadlock, trapped in the rigid yes or no dichotomy of choices. This is known as the dichotomy bias, a mental shortcut I introduced in my earlier video. The contrast between the confined room and the expansive outdoor environment primes the mindset of the participants. So the next time you are planning a meeting, consider it taking it outside the conventional boardroom. You may be surprised at the fresh perspectives and creative solutions that emerge when you think outside of the box, literally speaking. Similarly, when we are faced with a difficult choice, instead of agonizing whether to do X or Y, it's worth hitting the pause button. Instead, ask what other options are available, and you may find many untapped possibilities. Research suggests that religious beliefs may promote altruistic behavior across religious divides. In one study, researchers used priming techniques to prompt participants into reflecting on their God prior to making decisions in an economic game. The priming effect of thinking about God may have led to generosity towards both in-groups and out-groups religious members. Participants, regardless of their religious beliefs, exhibited a higher propensity for generous behavior towards strangers when encouraged to contemplate their deity. This increase in altruistic behavior was consistent whether the stranger shared their religious affiliation or not. The findings suggest religious belief may promote more positive intergroup relations rather than hostility between people who hold different views. The priming effect is also seen in relationships between religious beliefs and criminal behavior. When people are primed with the idea of a divine power, say, with phrases like God is watching you, there tends to be a rise in prosocial and cooperative behavior. Moreover, people's perception of God's character also plays a role. Priming with the idea of a punitive God reduces instances of cheating, whereas priming with an image of God as comforting and forgiving seems to increase dishonest behavior. A research study looked at what people believe about heaven and hell in 67 different countries. The study showed that in countries where more people believed in hell, the rates of crimes like assault, burglary, drug offenses, homicide, and rape tended to be lower. On the other hand, in countries where more people believed in heaven, the rates of those crimes tended to be higher. Given the priming effect, we need to pay attention to how we ask a question. Assume you are a researcher needing to approach supermarket shoppers to request their participation in a brief survey. Starting the conversation with, "Do you consider yourself a helpful person?" before presenting your survey request could prime their mind towards helpfulness, likely boosting your survey response rate. Your initial question can serve as a powerful tool to prime human minds in a specific direction. In education, FLO stands for Student Learning Outcome, a measure used to monitor students' learning progress. This measure can be established by teachers, principals, and other educational administrators, and it can be applied to any subject, grade level, or student group. Have you noticed that the abbreviation FLO, S-L-O, which is meant to represent growth and learning, phonetically resembles the word slow, S-L-O-W. Taking into account the priming effect, it's ironic that an acronym associated with learning progress may unconsciously imply sluggishness. In leadership, trust is the cornerstone of all human relationships. Questions such as, should I trust her with this task, or what level of trust can I place in him, often reshape our evaluation of a person's trustworthiness. Similarly, those we interact with evaluate our trustworthiness in the same way. Our words and actions are under constant scrutiny. The priming effect comes into play when we label those we interact with as partners or opponents. One study showed that participants exhibit greater levels of trust and were more inclined towards altruism when their interactions were framed as engaging with partners rather than opponents. Word choice is important. It carries significant weight in shaping perceptions and outcomes. Human faces are an important prime. When we see human faces, it not only triggers emotional responses, but also sets the stage for a particular pattern of thought, predisposing our mind to certain attitudes or behaviors. Let's look at an example in a medical context. If you want radiologists to devote more time and attention to x-rays and writing comprehensive reports, a simple strategy is to provide a photograph of yourself alongside your x-ray images. This addition of a personal element primes the radiologist, humanizing the process. Seeing your face as a personal dimension to the typically impersonal medical images, reminding the radiologist of the real person behind the x-ray, thereby encouraging a more thorough examination. Similarly, human faces play an important role in our subconscious judgment of in-group, those perceived as similar or familiar to us, and out-groups, those perceived as different or unfamiliar to us. A split-second exposure to a hostile or aggressive face, even though the duration is too brief for conscious recognition, such as only 16 milliseconds, shapes our perception. This exposure primes us to categorize the face as belonging as an out-group member, associating it with negative stereotype of out-groups. This priming process can have significant social consequences. It inadvertently heightens our feelings of aggression and hostility towards those we perceive as different or outside our own social group. Take a moment and look at this picture. Do you see two faces or a vase? Chances are you see two faces rather than a vase in the middle. Why? I've been discussing faces multiple times before I show the picture. I've been priming you to perceive faces over a vase. Let's look at another aspect of priming, the influence of background music. It can subtly change our perceptions and attitudes. When violent and misogynistic rap music is played, it can unconsciously evoke and reinforce negative stereotypes about Blacks. This is because rap music is stereotypically associated with Blacks more than whites. This association may already prime listeners to connect the music with certain racial stereotypes. The contextual cues, such as violent and misogynistic rap music, can sustain the negative stereotype activation or make it more cognitively demanding to suppress the stereotype. Both mental processes may result in a prolonged arousal response to Black faces, reflecting increased amygdala activity. The amygdala is a region in the brain associated with emotion and the social processing. This heightened activity could underline the unconscious reinforcement of stereotypes. In my earlier video, I introduced the in-group bias, our natural tendency to show favoritism towards our own group and view other groups as potential threats. Having understood the priming effect, let's consider how we can minimize negativity triggered by perceived threats from outgroups. Here are two options. Which one would you choose? A. Highlight the differences between in-groups and out-groups. B. prime people with experiences common to all humans? Do you choose A or B? Exposure to information about differences between in-groups and out-groups can activate the priming effect. When in-group members are primed with out-group information, they often perceive out-group members negatively. Similarly, when primed with in-group content, the in-group members often perceive out-group members as adversaries to mitigate the negativity induced by perceived threats from out-groups. It's more effective to prime people with shared human experiences, for example, love and relationships, loss and grief, hope and dreams, learning and curiosity, facing challenges and adversity, and celebrating achievements. It is counterproductive for diversity and inclusion if the focus is excessively on how one group differs from another, overshadowing the shared traits and experiences that bind us all as humans. Another powerful prime is smell. Our olfactory system directly interacts with the emotional centers of our brain, more so than other sensory systems like vision, hearing, and touch. If we happen to be sitting in a room where the unpleasant odor of garbage lingers, we may notice a shift in our views, becoming more socially conservative about issues such as gay marriage. This is because the repugnant smell triggers a sense of disgust, a feeling associated with the concepts of purity, including moral purity. If people want to subtly sway a liberal towards a conservative, priming them with an unpleasant smell could potentially do the trick. But the priming effect is fragile. If the goal were to sway a conservative towards more liberal views, it would be beneficial to remind them of the influence of the priming effect and encourage them not to let their instinctive disgust impact their decision-making. In organizations, people use both personal language, like we, and impersonal language, such as employees. The use of personal language primes people for a sense of warmth, intimacy, and a shared purpose. It reinforces the feeling of being part of a tight-knit team. However, this sense of closeness can be a double-edged sword. The increased in-group affiliation can inadvertently encourage dishonest behavior among its members. This is because once strong emotional bonds exist, it becomes more challenging to hold colleagues accountable or reprimand them for their misconduct, compared to dealing with colleagues who are not as closely tied to us. Accountability and impartiality may therefore be compromised when the sense of community is overly emphasized, demonstrating the subtle and sometimes paradoxical effects of linguistic priming in organizations. Start observing your decision-making process and those of others around you. See if you can spot instances of a priming effect. Please feel free to share your comments below. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.